thing that got me in my first submersible dive is once you leave the surface, when you're on the surface, you're bobbing around all over the place, and it's not particularly comfortable. But once you clear the surface and you start descending, suddenly it's quiet. It's like really quiet, and you're just gliding downwards. And it is genuinely very peaceful, and it's quite tranquil. And then when you eventually, 4 hours later, you start to see the bottom, the seafloor coming up towards you. And it's just like, wow. And there you are. The chances are we quite often are the first human beings ever to see this particular place. And you're looking out and you're taking stock of it. And quite often it doesn't sink in till afterwards, because once you're on the bottom, you have a job to do. And you're telling the pilot where to go. You're trying to photograph various things. You're trying to remember what the dive mission actually is and not just start chasing stuff, whatever. You know, so you're on it, and your adrenaline is obviously pretty up there. And you're trying to do it. And in the end, we dump our weight and the sub starts to float back up. And you have this weird 4 hours back to the surface where all the excitement is done. You've done it. You've seen what there is to see. And then you feel really tired. And quite often, I've nodded off asleep a couple of times on the way back up. And quite often, we just sit and watch a movie on someone's phone. And then for me, it feels like there's a big excitement when we get to the surface, because it's rough and you're rolling around and the ship's trying to pick you up and there's people jumping on the sub and everything else. So the last 10 minutes is pretty mental. It's not particularly pleasant, but it's all, you know, and you eventually climb out the submarine and everyone's like, woo, so great. And it's about 30 minutes later when you've got the suit off, you've got all your gear off and everything else, and you sit and you have a cup of coffee. And you think, wow.
Do you get nervous? Do you get anxious about it? Or is it like, all right, going to the bottom of the ocean and it's Wednesday?
Surprisingly not. I mean, we have had some incidences in the sub. We've had the hatch leaking at one point when we're thousands of meters underwater. And we've had an incident last September where we were nearly at the seafloor at 9,000 meters. And there was a big old mighty bang on the outside of the sub. And we couldn't place what it was. And so we had to abort. We got to make that decision in a space of like 60 seconds ago. Something just popped on the outside of the sub. We're still going down. And so pressure is only increasing. So we need to make the call. And you have this. And what's weird is in those situations, I think I trust the submarine so much, and the pilots trust it as well, that it's rather than nobody panics, nobody freaks out. And in fact, if anything, it's the opposite. You suddenly, because you're inside the submarine, you can't see out of it. Your eyesight is useless. And suddenly it's like your brain just reactivates everything to do with your hearing. And you're just sitting there listening. Is anything cracking? Is anything doing? You know, and then you're very quietly speaking to each other and saying, okay, what was that? What could it be? Should we be worried about this? Do we need to abort? And you just do it. And, you know, it's maybe something, like I said before about that, it's not till afterwards when you're sitting with a cup of coffee thinking out, what did I just do? Sometimes there's been a case where the same thing has happened there and you're thinking, oh, wow, we just aborted a dive at 9,000 meters and we're still not quite sure what it was that made that bang. And then you get the opposite. You're like, oh, maybe we should have freaked out. But I think in those, it must be the same as being like an airline pilot. If you're the type of person who freaks out when things go wrong, then you're probably in the wrong job. But you are locked in a small titanium ball, just two people in a ball that's probably no bigger than about, I think it's 1.2 meters diameter, and you're sitting in it for 12 hours.
Would you say that because you've gone down there many times, do you notice like, oh, now I'm in the deep sea? Like, is there a change that you kind of feel?
Yeah, there are multiple things that do change. For example, the temperature drops off pretty quick. So you could be 35 degrees Celsius on the surface, and by the time you get to 500 meters, you might be down to 5 degrees. By the time you get beyond 1,000 meters, you're less than 2 degrees. So there's a noticeable drop in temperature. And there's a noticeable drop in water quality as well. So on the surface, there's lots of things like plankton. And when you look out from the submersible, you'll see it's quite cloudy. There's a lot of stuff going on. And when you get down deep enough, it's actually pretty clear. And once you put the lights on, of course, you know it's very, very clean water. So, and there are lots of things that you don't get in the deep sea that you do get in the shallow end, like plants. So seaweeds. One of the reasons why 200 meters was suggested as a limit is because light penetration from the sun doesn't go that much further than that. So photosynthesis cannot occur. So you suddenly don't see any more seaweed or kelp or seagrass or anything like that. So there are some changes, but generally speaking, looking at the deep sea floor at 6,000 meters isn't that different from scuba diving at 20 meters at night.
Follow up that excellent answer with this question, of course, from our audience. How do you go to the bathroom?
Ah, yes, that question. There's two ways to overcome this. There are on a day you dive in the submarine, you normally get up maybe 4 hours before the dive, and basically you drink a couple of cups of water, coffee, whatever, and then that's it. You just stay off it. When you get thirsty, the trick is to just put half a glass of water in your mouth, swirl it around a bit, and spit it out. That seems to satisfy your thirst without taking on water. So that's a little trick that I do. I also have been blessed with an iron bladder, so it's never bothered me. And to the point where one of the guys I dive with quite a lot, one of the sub-pilots, he does not have an iron bladder. So he uses what is called the range extender, which is a plastic bottle. But just to wind him up, when we did a dive before, I was boasting about my iron bladder to the point where before we got in the submarine, I downed a whole pint of apple juice in front of him just to show. just to wind him up, saying, yeah, yep, doesn't bother me, mate.
As a person who does not have an iron bladder, I understand that you've been to the bottom of the ocean and gone to places that no one has been before, but holding it for 12 hours might be the most impressive